so an independent Caribbean person, to serve as president of the CIAB in his 107 years. I think that merits a round of applause. Mine is the honor to extend a warm welcome to you all and to try to establish this evening's protocol. I'm especially delighted that our overseas guests were able to join us. And, you know, I know it's a big effort for everyone, but for them, I extend a particularly warm welcome here tonight. With us is the Honorable Delroy Chuck, Minister of Justice, representing the Most Honorable Andrew Holness, Prime Minister of Jamaica, and truly Minister Chuck in your own right. I greet members of the Cabinet and the Attorney General, Senators. There are some other persons we hope to see later on in the evening. Allow me to acknowledge Mr. Justice David Fraser and other members of the judiciary in Jamaica and in the region. I am pleased to acknowledge the presence of the Right Honorable Sir Dennis Byron, former President of the Caribbean Court of Justice, and our own former Chief Justice, the Honorable Zayla McCullough. I welcome members of the Diplomatic Corps, Mr. John Bassie and Mrs. Paulette Bassie, as well as Menda Tribe Elder, Ms. Fatima Bassie, this evening. Our Custos of St. Andrew, and of course, a man we'll hear a lot from later on, Mr. Brian Brannon, Director of the Americas, representing Ms. Catherine Dixon, Director General of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. Also with us is Mr. Justice Gafford, Caribbean Branch Chair for CIAB, and Jamaica Branch Chair, Ms. Shani Nemard. I acknowledge the members of the clergy and members and leaders of other organizations, members of the bar, representatives of the private sector, mediators and arbitrators. Mrs. Cheryl Taylor, Operations Manager at the Dispute Resolution Foundation and the engine behind much of what is occurring tonight, and other staff and members of the Dispute Resolution Foundation and the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators in person or online. I also acknowledge John's many brothers who are here in support of him this evening. Thank you so much for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, it is my delight to welcome you, and in doing that, to also acknowledge our kind sponsors, Public Broadcasting Corporation, PBC, Tip Friendly Society, Sioke Sodality Limited, Credit Union Limited, and the National Council on Drug Abuse. I extend to each and everyone a very warm welcome, and let me say, I promise you, that's the longest I'll be standing at this lectern for the rest of the function. So thank you all for coming out, and at this point, it is my pleasure to invite John's childhood friend, the very distinguished scholar and clergyman, Dr. Reverend Devon Dick, to do the invocation.
Thank you very much, Madam Honorable Donna Parchment Brown. Those who are able to stand, please stand. This is the day that the Lord has made. We are rejoicing and we are happy and glad. We remember, O God, the advent of your Son Jesus Christ into this world, with the hope for peace on earth and goodwill towards all peoples. We pray, O God, that this global organization will facilitate global peace, well-being, flourishing, prosperity, unity, and love. We confess, O Lord, that by word and deed, we have done things that have harmed others and have not been proactive in peacemaking, dispute resolution. But we thank you that in your wisdom, you have selected your servant John to preside at this time over this global organization of arbitrators, so that your purpose, your divine will be done, and there will be harmonious relationships between peoples, between countries, between companies and communities. We thank you for John, his intellect, his compassion, his humility. May he continue to serve without seeking any reward. May he continue to serve, going the extra mile without complaining or comparing his contribution to others. May he continue to serve to the best of his ability. We recall, Lord, at this time, the many senseless slaughtering and conflicts in our land, Jamaica, in the Caribbean, Sierra Leone, in Africa, in Asia, in Europe, Ukraine and Russia. Challenges for First Nation peoples, Australia, in Canada. Oh Lord, may this Chartered Institute of Arbitrators be a vehicle through which persons can find fullness of life, fairness, access to resources, and being able to live in harmony with one another. This sermon, we pray, God, that you will grant again unto John wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Pray that all who will participate, all that they will say and do, will bring honor and glory to your name. This we pray and ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you very much, Reverend Dick, for sending us off to a powerful start this evening. We have several arbitrators, mediators, and other colleagues of John in the room, and I just want to make sure I've acknowledged them. And of course, we have with us Mr. David Shepherd, the Deputy British High Commissioner, who we'll hear more from later on. We're doing something extra special because, as you know, it's 2022, and we have learned over the last 2 years how to use technology to bring us close together, even when we're thousands of miles apart. And so there are a number of persons who would have liked to be here with us, but were unable to join us and in person. However, some have gone through the effort of making congratulatory messages. So I'm going to invite you to turn your attention to the video screens as we view congratulatory messages from Miss Aisha Bassie, John and Paulette's daughter, Marie Camille Pitton, Secretary General, OHADAC, Miss Jane Gunn, Global Immediate Past President of CIR, Chief Gabola Akinola, Nigerian Branch Chair, Miss Catherine Dixon, Director General, Mike Ogbalu from the Pan-African Payment and Settlement System, and Judge Jeffrey Elkinson, a former global president and Bermuda chair for the CIAB. So sit back and enjoy the kind remarks that will come from these persons.
Hello, I'm Jane Gunn. I'm the current president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, and I wanted to wish a really heartfelt congratulations to John Bassie on his presidency for the coming year. John and I have collaborated over this last year. I know he's got some really interesting ideas, themes and initiatives, and I know that John's going to have an absolutely fantastic year. So thank you, John. Well done. Congratulations. And I look forward to continuing to work with you. Hello, I'm Jane Gunn. I'm the current president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, and I wanted to wish a really heartfelt congratulations to John Bassie on his presidency for the coming year. John and I have collaborated over this last year. I know he has some really interesting ideas, themes and initiatives, and I know that John's going to have an absolutely fantastic year. So thank you, John. Well done. Congratulations. And I look forward to continuing to work with you. Hello, I'm Jane Gunn. I'm the current president of the
Ladies and gentlemen, all types of technology challenges. I think some of you might have remembered the technology of rubbing the floor with that coconut brush. Not everybody did a good job of it. We all have to master. And sometimes it's a brush, sometimes it's just us. So we'll continue to be together until they're able to give us sound and video.
Well done. Congratulations. And I look forward to continuing to work with you.
I'll take the opportunity to acknowledge the presence of Mr. Leonard Green, President of the Advocates Association. And in the front row, I'm seeing Mr. Julian Robinson, MP, as well as Senator Donna Scott Motley, Opposition Spokesperson on Justice. Welcome. I was chided by somebody sitting not too far from me that I had not mentioned the word Calabar and he was not going to have it. So I've mentioned the word Calabar. we know, hopefully we will be able to not have to do that 10 times this evening. As we get to the other video. So we know that the persons who we have invited to provide these videos have put a lot of effort and love into them. So I'm really hoping that as we go forward, we will get them. However, while we wait on that, we won't be just waiting idly. We will be thrilled. We will be thrilled because we have the very talented gentleman, Mr. Giovanni Williams, a violinist. I'm going to invite you to relax and enjoy Giovanni's music, but let me tell you that he's a multi-award winning musician with a bachelor's degree in viola performance and has received many accolades both locally and internationally, as well as opportunities to study and do master classes for those interested in music. I now invite Mr. Giovanni Williams to perform for us. Thank you. It's no wonder it's a perfect ponder how the talented Jamaicans, and indeed across the Caribbean. And indeed today is a happy day, because John, you are the man that fights for the right and not the wrong. And the rest of you know the rest of them, right? So we're now going to return to the videos, and I ask again that we give our attention to the screens.
Fraternal greetings on behalf of the entirety of the membership of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators Nigerian Branch, to our beloved incoming president, global, of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, Mr. John Bassie. We of the Nigerian branch send these greetings to you to felicitate and congratulate you most heartily on your investiture, which we believe is a testament of your capacity, dedication to work, excellence, and of course, integrity. We at the Nigerian branch offer you our unalloyed support, and it is our prayer that the Almighty God will continue to sustain you with good health and peace of mind. We wish you success in your new position as the global president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, and look forward to working with you to achieve the objectives of the Institute. We equally look forward to receiving you in Lagos in November of 2023 at our annual conference, which is scheduled for that period, and trust that we will be counted as part of your monumental success as the global president of the Chartered Institute. Mr. John Bassie, heartiest congratulations.
My name is Catherine Dixon, and I'm the Director General of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. I wanted to take this opportunity to send a personal message of congratulations to John Bassie, who's been appointed today as CIARB's Global President for 2023. I'm so sorry that I can't be with you, but I know that John will do a fantastic job as our global president and representing the alternative dispute resolution community around the world. Thank you, John, and congratulations. And I'm so looking forward to working with you in 2023. Thank you.
Greetings all in Kingston. It is a great honor and a privilege to be able to address you this evening and be part of the ceremony to welcome John Bassie in his presidency of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators for the year 2023. It is an honor for me because I've known John for a very long time. I have very happy memories of being in Kingston with him and other countries too, not least Sierra Leone, when John joined with me in conducting charitable work there to bring the arbitration process to the people of Sierra Leone. So tonight is all about John, as it often can be, but in all sincerity, John, I wish you the very best in your presidency. It is fantastic to have a president from the Caribbean there. I was president when I was, and still am, living in Bermuda, but as you know, Bermuda is not in the Caribbean. John, the very best, and the best to all in Kingston tonight.
Marie-Camille Piton, Secretary General of the OHADAC Regional Arbitration Center. John, I would like to congratulate you for your appointment as Global President of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. This is an incredible achievement and also a historical moment for ADR practitioners around the region. So congratulations again. I'm very much looking forward to working with you next year, and I wish you a great investiture ceremony.
Hi, so my name is Aisha Bassie, the proud daughter of John Bassie. Yes, his number one baby girl that he mentions to almost everyone. Hi Daddy, I just want to say congratulations to you on your new success, your new journey that you're about to start. I want to say that I am exceptionally proud of you for working hard, having sleepless nights, because it all paid off in the end. Daddy, I want you to always remember that God is will always be by your side and that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Daddy, you have made me proud. And I know we miss each other, but we will reunite soon. I just want to say congrats one more time. I hope you enjoy this new journey. And I know you'll make me proud the same way I'm over here making you proud. Daddy, continue to shine, continue to be who you are. And I know mommy's proud of you, I'm proud of you, and the family's proud, and your colleagues are proud. Congrats, and I love you very much. Congrats one more time, Daddy.
I think you will agree with me that those were wonderful messages. We thank all those who took the time to prepare them and to share them with us. And of course, Miss Aisha Bassie, the baby girl, saying to Daddy what he has said to her many times. So she's been listening, John. So we are now moving into another section of the program, and it will involve a video. So it is my pleasure to invite my friend, fellow traveler, arbitrator, and all-around wonderful Caribbean woman, Ms. Justice Charmaine Pemberton, Judge of the Trinidad and Tobago Court of Appeal, to bring greetings on behalf of the region. We will now see her video.
It's always so exciting when someone you regard as a friend and a colleague attains success and remarkable achievements. For many years, the CIARB Caribbean branch has been synonymous with the name John Bassie. John has toiled for years in the proverbial vineyards to bring arbitration to the region, for it to take its rightful place and be recognized as a most viable form of dispute settlement. This has eased backlogs and burdens of our court system, especially in technical matters. Under John's leadership and guidance, the Caribbean branch has hosted a number of sensitization programs, resulting in training a vast number of regional arbitrators, from introductory to fellows levels. The regional body today now stands among the stalwart branches of the International Institute. Many of us have to thank him for that perseverance and above all, his sterling contribution to our legal landscape. In fact, one of our jurisdictions in the Caribbean was so impressed with CIRB's programs and graduates that one of our court systems, Belize, has introduced court-connected arbitration. Through his unwavering efforts and single-mindedness, and sometimes at personal expense, John has served diligently Caribbean people and the Caribbean branch in particular with distinction. In fact, such was the work that Sir Dennis Byron could only accede to his request to become the first patron of the Caribbean branch. As John worked towards this preferment, he behaved with such humility, grace, and kindness to others. I say without fear of contradiction that these efforts were all against a backdrop of fearless spirit, of fierce determination, and a selflessness to elevate the administration of justice in the Caribbean through the Chartered Institute. John's efforts were not confined to this region. Over the years, this individual has managed to use his skills and talents in leadership, organization, and management to influence persons from Africa, the Middle East, and I dare say at home base, to train as arbitrators and to use that method of effective dispute settlement. As far as the Institute is concerned, here is an individual who has represented you on many international committees and fora, an individual who is well placed and well suited to provide effective and efficient leadership. I am thankful and continue to be so impressed with the contribution that you, John, have made to the field. I always knew you were special and had big things coming, John. May I therefore be allowed to say a hearty congratulations and best wishes as you chart this new but not totally unexpected role of leadership in your professional life. Rest assured that we in the region and all others who you have touched stand ready and willing to support you in making your tenure a resounding success. Thank you for the opportunity to say these few words.
Has been an important proponent of ADR in our region and has helped to plant the deep roots that have developed. We thank her for her kind remarks on behalf of the region. Miles and Justice Kafour, I know you're feeling good about what she has said there, represented you well, I think. And we're grateful that she has taken the time to be with us today, a very important part of the development of regional arbitration. And I think it's important to make the point, Minister, that although arbitration has been around a long time, and there have been Jamaican members, from when the figures were 005, what has happened now is significantly different from where we were before. And we hope this will continue to benefit the justice system, Jamaica, the region, and our friends around the world. Let me say that although we asked late and he responded late, we are going to have the pleasure of hearing from somebody who's very, very pleased to be with us this evening, representing a very important country in the world of arbitration and in Jamaica's own history. With us this evening is the Deputy British High Commissioner, Mr. Daniel Shepherd. And I now invite him to speak to us. But let me tell you before he comes that he's just been in Jamaica since 2020, so he's just beginning to be outside. And before coming here, he has served in New Delhi, Hanoi, New York, and Pretoria. So he has had a very broad experience in the diplomatic service. I invite you now, Mr. Shepherd.
Honourable Donna Patrick Brown, Minister Chuck, distinguished guests, of which there are too many to mention, so I'll just say all protocols observed. As Deputy and Acting British High Commissioner at the moment, I'll say that while I can for the next couple of days. It's an honour and a real pleasure to be here tonight to witness the historic investiture of Mr. John Bassie as Global President of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. I'm confident that he will preside over a continuing period of growth in the relevance and the prevalence of this vital mechanism of dispute resolution. Since its establishment in 1915, London has been the home of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, and it's a very suitable location for the headquarters. I may be biased, but I think it's a very suitable location for the headquarters, given my government's support for trusted, efficient systems of justice and dispute settlement. Over centuries, from England's medieval marketplaces to the present day, arbitration has developed into such a trusted system, especially for commercial cases. The advantages in many situations of arbitration over court-based dispute settlements are well known. The speed of decision making, the subject specialist expertise of many arbitrators, including many in this room, the lower cost, and the enforceability across international boundaries, thanks to the 1958 New York Convention, ratified by almost every country in the world, and where commercial confidentiality is a factor, the secrecy of proceedings. Access to arbitration in any country including Jamaica, is vital to building business confidence. It is well known that here in Jamaica, and in many countries, there is a substantial backlog of commercial cases in court, some of which may be amenable to more expeditious settlement through arbitration. So I believe that the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators can play an important role in promoting greater access to arbitration, including through its global network, by training more professionals to be arbitrators with its academic and professional resources, and through the demonstration effect. Arbitration works. Speaking for the UK, we want to see an enhancement of bilateral trade relations with Jamaica and with the wider Caribbean and wider economic development in the region. And this was part of our motivation for concluding the UK-CARIFORUM Economic Partnership Agreement, or EPA. But this won't come about only from the tariff and the quota reductions in the EPA, in the agreement, but from other measures to improve business confidence and certainty. And that includes the efficient settlement of any disputes. For this reason, the agreement requires both the UK and CARIFORUM, the members of CARIFORUM, that's the members of CARICOM, plus the Dominican Republic, to set up a joint panel of arbitrators to address any disputes arising under the agreement. So we as the UK look forward to CARIFORUM identifying their proposed list for the panel. And perhaps some of their potential nominees are in this audience tonight. Let us see. Mr. Bassie, many congratulations. I wish you all success for your term in office and have full confidence that you will deliver on the ambitious strategic aims of the Chartered Institute in Jamaica, in the Caribbean, and now worldwide. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Excellency. There's a saying in Jamaica, I don't want to call on Minister Chuck again, so I think I'm going to call on Senator Scott Motley. One day, Bakra Bakra, he says he's acting as a High Commissioner just for the moment, but I think he has certainly represented the United Kingdom very well tonight. Thank you so much. We're very pleased that the Chartered Institute is with us in Jamaica tonight, in the person of Mr. Brian Brannon, CIRB Director of the Americas. Mr. Brannon will present the address from Director General Catherine Dixon, who cannot be with us in person. Brian, the Caribbean and the Americas that you represent, we welcome you to this occasion of many firsts. This global organization is of tremendous importance, and you serve in a very large part of it. We welcome you most warmly and now invite you to deliver the address.
Good evening. Thank you, Your Honorable Parchment Brown. Distinguished colleagues, it is a pleasure to be here this evening. Jamaica, we have a global president of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. May we have a round of applause. It's a distinct honor to be in Jamaica on behalf of Catherine Dixon, Chartered Institute of Arbitrators Director General, to provide the keynote address at our friend and colleague, John Bassie's Chartered Institute of Arbitrators Presidential Investiture Ceremony. My name is Brian J. Brannon, and I am the CIRB's Regional Relationship Manager for the Americas. I am CIRB's first ever Americas-based employee in the 107-year-old history. In this role, I have the privilege of working within the Americas, and in particular with seven branches, one of them being the Caribbean. I have the privilege of working with Miles Weeks, fellow of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and immediate past chair of the Caribbean branch. In addition, Justice Anthony Gafour, Trinidad and Tobago chapter chair and current president of the Caribbean branch. In addition, Shawnee Nemhard, Jamaica chapter chair and member of the Caribbean branch. And the distinguished members of the Caribbean branch and its Jamaica chapter here today, which we thank John for helping to found, lead, and grow. Thank you, John. On behalf of Catherine and all of our Chartered Institute of Arbitrators colleagues, both in London and abroad, we're grateful for John's generous invitation to provide tonight's keynote. And we are thrilled to join in this celebration as we prepare for more growth, challenge, and success during John's tenure in the year ahead. Catherine provides the following. I'm sorry to not be with you for the investiture of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators' new president, John Bassie. I'm delighted that Brian has been able to attend on my behalf, and I'm very grateful for him for reading out this speech. I didn't write that. We're so excited to welcome John as the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators' new president. John is the first Chartered Institute of Arbitrators president from the Caribbean, and was a founding member of the CIARB's Caribbean branch, which was launched in November 2007. Today, the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators Caribbean branch is the third most populous branch out of the seven Americas branches in the Americas. It's a testament to John's hard work and to the hard work of the Chartered Institute of members in the Caribbean. I know that you'll hear much about John today and his commitment to the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and to dispute resolution. But for those of you who don't know John's background, John is a barrister at law and attorney at law. The founder and managing attorney of John S. Bassie and Co. He's also a qualified accountant. John is the current vice president of the Jamaican Bar Association and chair of the Dispute Resolution Foundation of Jamaica, which just celebrated its 25th anniversary and is believed to be one of the oldest or the oldest ADR provider organization in the Caribbean. John is also a chartered arbitrator, Supreme Court appointed mediator in Florida and Jamaica, and justice of the peace and part of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators approved faculty list. John has over 21 years of practice in the Caribbean, North America, the United Kingdom, and Africa, as well as serving as an ADR on ADR working groups at the United Nations. And we know that he will provide, continue to provide his experience and expertise to raise the profile of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and alternative dispute resolution in the Caribbean and around the world, while serving as the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators president in 2023. We're honored to have John as our president at what is an exciting time for the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and for dispute resolution globally as it continues to develop and increase its influence in areas including sustainability, environmental, social, and governance, and to adapt and change in line with technological advances. Our world is facing significant challenges: climate change, cost of living concerns, conflict, and unrest. I'm confident that arbitration, mediation, and all forms of alternative dispute resolution can play a crucial role in supporting sustainability in the future. And I know that John will be a fantastic ambassador for the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and for alternative dispute resolution. Many of you are familiar with the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, indeed, and many of you are members, but it would be remiss of Catherine if she didn't take the opportunity to tell you a little bit about the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. The Chartered Institute of Arbitrators is a global membership organization and professional body dedicated to effective dispute resolution. Our global membership is growing to over 17,500 alternative dispute resolution professionals in 150 jurisdictions throughout the world. We also have 42 branches globally, which are run by members for members. Undertaking activities such as networking, webinars, lectures, professional practice support, career development, thought leadership, and training, including, of course, this event today. The Chartered Institute of Arbitrators' aims are to globally promote constructive resolution of disputes, be a global, inclusive thought leader, and to develop and support an inclusive global community of diverse dispute resolvers. Our vision is a world where disputes are resolved promptly, effectively, and creatively. And our mission is to be an inclusive global thought leader in dispute resolution, promoting and facilitating the creative and effective resolution of disputes, supporting equality, diversity, and inclusion, and ensuring practitioners are highly trained and comply with professional standards and ethical rules. Our mission sets out our commitment to supporting equality, diversity, and inclusion, enabling the best to join, and the ADR profession, irrespective of their background, the rule of law, and enabling access to justice globally. As a royal chartered body registered in England, we're also dedicated to driving and supporting professional and ethical standards. The Chartered Institute of Arbitrators awards post-nominals once you've successfully completed the training and become a member. Our post-nominals are recognized around the world, including by many arbitral institutions and arbitration and mediation panels. We provide professional practice guidance and have, by way of example, recently launched a technology and arbitration professional practice guideline. We have expert groups on ADR disciplines, technology, and sustainability. We're also an active participant in UNCITRAL's working group 2 and 3, and we are observer status to represent our members globally. The Chartered Institute of Arbitrators also has a dedicated young members group, and practitioners in the early stages of their career benefit from networking with other younger practitioners around the world. I'd like to finish with a thank you to everyone who has attended today. I'm sorry I couldn't be with you. I do hope you enjoy the event. I'd also like to send my very best wishes to John. Catherine wishes you every success in your presidential year, and we're very much looking forward to working with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brian Brannon and Ms. Catherine Dixon. We are all better informed about the Institute, about John Bassie, and how we can build better countries and a better world as we use these competencies to address disputes in a timely, respectful, and confidential manner, and as a complement to our court systems. Let me say that this event is being streamed live on PBC Jamaica, which I think means that although you're here this evening, tomorrow if you want to watch it, you can also see it again on PBC. And those guests who could not join us in person may be enjoying your presence on television. Jamaica's Prime Minister, the Most Honorable Andrew Holness, could not be with us this evening. He has kindly asked the Honorable Delroy Chuck, Minister of Justice, and a longtime friend and advocate for ADR to be our speaker tonight. This is truly an excellent choice, as under his leadership, the Ministry of Justice has prioritized ADR in its own programs and many in partnership with the Dispute Resolution Foundation, and we thank you for that, Minister. Jamaica also, through Minister Chuck, is a signatory to the Singapore Accord. This signals to us all that Jamaica wants to build strong pillars beneath our global standing as among the happiest countries on earth. Still working on it, but maybe we can achieve it. We know conflict will arise, but knowing where to go for good outcomes is vital as we look at the array of issues that national leaders must tackle. Mr. Chuck, it is my honor to invite you to the podium to deliver your address.
Thank you very much, Honorable Donna Panchman-Brown. It's easy to say all protocols observed. But let me, with your permission, just recognize my political colleagues, Mr. Julian Robinson and Senator Donna Scott Motley, to recognize distinguished members of the judiciary, certainly Sir Dennis Byron, who is here visiting with us, former Chief Justice Dale McCullough, Mr. David Fraser, Court of Appeal Judge, and I know there are other members of the judiciary from here and abroad. And also, I must recognize Mrs. Taylor from the DRF, who I've been dealing with on a regular basis. But distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me congratulate you, John, and also the support that Paulette has been giving you over the decades. This is a real signal honor, and Jamaica is proud of you. You're joining a distinguished group of Jamaicans who have really excelled on the world stage. I need not mention the great musical stars, we all know who they are, and the great athletes who have made Jamaica proud, our men athletics team and our female runners. But they're also descendants of Jamaicans who have excelled right across the globe, especially in England and North America. Indeed, I notice Raheem Sterling, who was born here in Jamaica, is heading back to Qatar to try and get England the World Cup. And I want to tell you, Mr. Shepherd, that at the embassy last week, Thursday, your High Commissioner promised that if England reached the final, you will be having a celebration at, you will be hosting us at the High Commission to watch the World Cup. John, may I say that you have been championing not only mediation but and arbitration, but ADR. When I tabled and really pushed the Arbitration Act in 2017, I think it was, I emphasized that we wanted Jamaica to be an arbitration center. We modeled the Jamaican Arbitration Act of the UNCITRAL model law so that any arbitrator anywhere in the world could be here in Jamaica or utilize our law in arbitration. I must say I'm a little disappointed that we're still at the infancy stage in arbitration in Jamaica. And shortly I will try to see how best we can really get arbitration going. But not only arbitration, mediation. John and I were in Singapore when I signed on behalf of Jamaica the Singapore Convention on Mediation. And since I've been Minister of Justice, I have seen the need for ADR. And ADR, in terms of arbitration, mediation, restorative justice, victim services, to assist in resolving disputes across homes, neighborhoods, and communities, is something that not only the Ministry of Justice, but all Jamaicans should really not only focus, but really emphasize. Here in Jamaica, we have so many, well, all countries, but more so in Jamaica, daily conflicts. And the reason why more so in Jamaica, we resolve conflicts, not by appropriate means, but the most inappropriate means. In many communities, we think that violence is the way to solve problems. So Jamaica has one of the highest murder rates in the world. And the reason for this is not so much the domestic murders. They're less than 25%. But just around 75% of our murders are where gangs are fighting one another, or where you have street battles. And the point here is that communities and groups have not been able to work out their differences. It's almost a great challenge to get them to look at one another, to get them to the table. I saw this over 20 years ago when I tried to bring the gangs together in my constituency. They resisted. When I tried to bring the gang leaders, and here I'm going out of my way to meet with gang leaders, to meet with gangs, to see if I can pull them together. I went to the prisons to meet them. and the gang leaders were in prison, they would not look at one another. They would shake their hands while not looking at one another. And when they came back into the communities, and I tried to get them in the church vestries, certainly at Selamar's Foundation and various other churches, they would meet, but they don't look at one another. You literally to tell them, pull their face to try and look at one another and even shake hands. And I started with the Ministers Fraternal to find out if the Ministers Fraternal could assist me in getting these warring factions, not even gangs. They were gangs, but loose. I was able to succeed by bringing them onto the football field, bringing them to church. So they had to go to church first and then play football afterwards. But the point really is, we have over 300 gangs in a little country like this, all fighting one another. And when they fight one another, it's no longer with stones and machetes, it's with guns. So we have many, many instances of gun murders. Clearly, Jamaica needs alternative dispute resolution, because we cannot allow violence, and in the homes, domestic violence and abuses to solve the problems. We have victim services, we have all the opportunity for persons in the home, spouses, to really get counseling. We put on many programs, but they're not making use of them. We have 20 restorative justice centers where people in dispute can attend, but people are not making use of them. And what they do, if they don't kill one another in the streets or use power play, because you find that they feel the way to solve problem is to demonstrate who has the most power, whether it by the guns, or whether by brute force. It's a power play that far too many of our citizens use to solve problems. Then, for the quieter ones, they go to court. But they still have the difficulty, because in the Supreme Court, mediation is mandatory. But we still have far too many cases unresolved, so that cases are now being set for 26 and 27 and beyond. Now, that, to my mind, is a lose-lose situation, when mediation is a win-win situation. If they got together and really tried to solve their problems, it is a win-win situation. But when you have a case that is set 5 years' time, it has to be a lose-lose situation. I don't think either party really win waiting 5 years to have a dispute, to have a case settled. I am trying very hard in the parish courts to see how we can get more of these less difficult cases dealt with, not only by restorative justice, but by mediation. When I spoke with the Chief Justice, he said, and urge the judges to refer more matters to ADR and emphasize that ADR is an appropriate means rather than spending time in court for months waiting on the case to be settled. The Chief Justice said, well, a lot of litigants, regrettably, can't afford the mediation fee. They can't even afford the bus fare to come to court, much less the mediation fee. So I decided a couple of years back to get funds so that if the parish court judge refer a matter to mediation, we pay for it. And if they refer a matter to restorative justice, we pay for it. But we also encourage victims to go to victim services to get counseling and to avoid retaliation, because frequently that is what happens. And it is working quite a bit. when matters are referred to restorative justice, 93% of the cases are settled. And in mediation, the figure is way in excess of 60%. But you still have the challenge of convincing Jamaicans to really settle matters even before they come to court. And I say, John, this is a challenge for you. How do we promote ADR even more? And I say this because people do not see the benefit of using ADR and avoiding court. Let's deal with arbitration first. My hope is, John, that as the head now of CIARB, that you will bring more cases to Jamaica or more arbitrators to come to Jamaica where the matters can be dealt with. I feel the serene climate, not only of the beaches, but of, you know, Newcastle. Noel Coward found Firefly in St. Mary to the most peaceful place. Ian Fleming found, you know, the all of St. Mary to be so peaceful that he bought out GoldenEye, where he wrote all of his James Bond books. And I remember meeting a writer at Sanssouci some years ago, and he was there for the 42nd time in about 5 years. And I said, but why do you come back here so often? He says, this is the most peaceful place he has been on earth. And the point I'm really making, John, you need to say to your 17,000 arbitrators, urge the parties to come to Jamaica. We, the arbitrators, can come, would like to go to Jamaica, where we have the opportunity in a serene atmosphere to really meet with you away from the maddened crowd of the cities, the big cities, but right here in small Jamaica, and see if more cases can be dealt with. In addition, I would say, David Daniel says that the headquarters is in London. Just for 6 months, move it to Jamaica for a while. You're, as president, it's an opportunity for you to say, move the secretariat here for a while so that the 17,000 arbitrators can deal with Jamaica, even for 6 months. In addition, John, Justice Charmaine Pemberton mentioned that Belize is now bringing engaging arbitration as a part of the court system. I heard about this, but I don't know how it works. I would urge you to let us work with the Chief Justice and the judges to see how we can make arbitration a part of the court system. It would help in the disposal of cases. I don't think arbitration would be appropriate in the parish courts, but we have to push mediation more. When 70,000 cases on average come to the parish courts, it's impossible for the judges to deal with all of them. And they're working overtime now, even to get rid of the backlog. But I would say we need to push this ADR arbitration in particular, to let our commercial entities know that we have trained arbitrators right here in Jamaica, and if needed, they can be brought in from abroad. So big companies are now coming to Jamaica. And what is very important is that not only arbitration, but shortly mediation, if they come here and they make a decision, then that decision is enforceable in any jurisdiction, which is the basis of the UNCITRAL model and arbitration and mediation. So John, I want to encourage you as a Jamaican president to make sure that Jamaica benefits from your presidency by bringing as many of the 17,000 chartered arbitrators to Jamaica over the next year. I wish you well in your presidency.
Thank you very much, Minister Chuck. I feel I should have introduced you as the Minister of Tourism. As well as industry. So thank you so much for those insights and for your affirmation of our president and of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. I know you're working overtime to find good solutions for Jamaica as part of the Global Village. And it is certain that the Dispute Resolution Foundation, which through your evaluation in 1996, the first evaluator of the organization gave it the gold star, and it continues today. So your work has gone before you. But certainly, CIAB is at your service. We have had a lot of food for thought. I now ask our talented violinist, Mr. Giovanni Williams, to give us just a little bit more sugar, a bit more food for the soul, before we move on to the next segment.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Williams. It is quite appropriate that the song of the century should be played when we are thinking of the office of the century, the first in over 100 years for this to happen. We won't worry about anything because it's all one love. CJ McCalla, I'm so delighted you're able to be here because you have played such an important role in John's journey on this area of ADR. And allow me to also just briefly point out Steve Shelton and Dr. Eileen Boxill. Your roles have been really important. So, I believe that was really a fitting prelude to the formal public investiture of Mr. John Bassie. I now invite on stage Mr. Brian Brannon, Director of the Americas. That title is incorrect, do forgive me, but it's not a bad title anyway.
Give me a
promotion. Okay, to join us here on stage, Brian, please, as well as Mrs. Cheryl Taylor. In middle of the stage, please. Thank you so much. You may be wondering what that table covered in the black cloth on the platform is, and it has a very important thing on it, and hopefully as the evening progresses, everybody will go up to John and say, show me, okay, because something is going to happen with it. It is my honor and pleasure to now invite President John Bassie and his dear wife, Mrs. Paulette Bassie, to join us on the stage. In the center. To the front, yes, thank you. Mr. Brannon, I invite you to take the insignia of office and to place it around the neck of your new president.
It'll be my honor.
I now invite Mrs. Cheryl Taylor to make a presentation to Mrs. Paulette Bassie. As we know, Paulette is a dynamic, phenomenal woman, and she has played a very big role in what has been attained up to now and will continue to play an important role. And John wants to indicate that by this bouquet of roses that's been presented to her. So we have had the photo moment, and I think we can do better on the applause. I mean, you know. I will now ask John to escort Paulette back to her seat, and then momentarily he will return. Thank you very much, Cheryl and Brian.
Thank you.
We will now hear from the man of the hour, President Mr. John Bassie, a son of Jamaica, Sierra Leone, and the United Kingdom. He's a Caribbean man and world citizen, a lawyer, an accountant, arbitrator, mediator, man of the Americas and indeed the globe, and the first Caribbean president elected by the 107-year-old Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. Come forward, Mr. President.
Ooh. allow me to set up myself.
Well, where do I begin?
I want to thank the moderator for going through the protocol, and you, my friends and colleagues, for being here with me tonight. Thank you. I have put a few words together to organize my thoughts so we can have a little talk together this evening. I'm not as eloquent as Minister Chuck, who just off the cuff said a few words, and of course, the acting High Commissioner of the United Kingdom and all the other speakers have gone before. But I certainly intend to hopefully reach the audience here and around the globe who have taken time out of their busy schedule to be with me this evening. So my fellow ADR practitioners in the Americas, Europe, Asia, and Africa, good afternoon, good night, and good morning. I am required to provide a response this evening as we conclude this part of the festivities. I would first like to thank God for providing us with this unique opportunity to share a collective joy to celebrate the global presidency of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators that is being received by a member of the Americas of the Caribbean branch as a Jamaican here in Kingston, Jamaica, this evening. This has been nothing short of an international team effort. We thank the Director General, Catherine Dixon, and her hardworking team in the United Kingdom. We thank the international support of the global branches. I thank the Caribbean branch and the Jamaican chapter for its constant presence and support. I thank Mrs. Cheryl Taylor and the DRF family for spearheading the planning event, along with Maxine Brown. I want to thank Mrs. Donna Parchment Brown. Please give her a warm, rousing round of applause. Who has done such a beautiful job in guiding our evening so far. And I thank my family, home and office, for their constant support. My children, Aisha, Julian, and Jason, and in particular, my wife and best friend, Paulette. This has truly been an auspicious occasion. I would like to especially thank the members, the branch chairs, and the Chartered Institute for the opportunity to serve the organization in this ambassadorial role. As the world ascends from the spectre of the COVID-19 pandemic and we reach out to regain a sense of normalcy, I believe that we should take stock, and that is take the time to reflect on where we as alternative dispute resolution practitioners and global citizens are coming from, and as such, where we are heading. As the world looks to find its footing and regularity, I've always said that we have a unique opportunity to reflect on how our organization, the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, can favorably impact the lives of persons. We have seen over the last 2 years the Institute and its members rising to the challenges presented to us. The challenge of using our vast experience and versatile membership to continue to provide excellent alternative dispute resolution services whilst embracing the need to adapt and grow. Most of us ADR practitioners are practicing arbitrators, adjudicators, and mediators, just to name a few of the mechanisms in our craft. We can remember times when we've had to encourage parties to try different ADR mechanisms, such as restorative justice, arbitration, negotiation, conciliation, and mediation. Fellow practitioners, think about this for a moment. We are now able to practice our craft in a timely, efficient, and cost-effective way that if we tabulate and learn our lessons properly from the last 3 years, we can find ourselves on the threshold of contributing to the resolution of disputes by the use of non-costly, non-traditional, though adversarial mechanisms. Whilst the Chartered Institute has already put in place a pandemic dispute resolution service, which was intended to assist business entities that were facing disputes resulting from the pandemic. I believe that it's necessary for us to have a more surgical, organized, and systematic approach to harnessing ADR power that exists through mediation and combination-type ADR services, such as MEDARB or ARBMED, just to name a few. In continuation of the vision promulgated and lessons gleaned over the past pandemic years, I envisage the following. A specific set of protocols that will provide training of elite first responder type mediators. Think about it. These mediators will be called into emergencies, from war through to climate change, but more particularly in additional areas affecting us close to home. We all know in the Americas that a serious hurricane or storm affects schools, communities, our judicial system, and our businesses. Mediation and ADR can play a critical initiative-taking role. What is the result? In some countries, the already overworked and stretched resources will have a partner to assist in those areas that need immediate assistance and attention. I believe that such a force could be called on from different jurisdictions, mobilized to operate anywhere within a particular region, and provide much needed relief with measurable metrics. I believe with working with like-minded organizations, such as the Dispute Resolution Foundation, as our Chartered Institute strategic plan encourages, we can create a much anticipated network. This network would provide the fuel to move us towards a real game changer in our global citizens' lives. My dear global brothers and sisters, the Honorable Minister Delroy Chuck, representative of the Most Honorable Andrew Holness, our Prime Minister here in Jamaica, and might I add, Minister Chuck is an ardent supporter of ADR. Our ADR industry recognizes that we are now in a position to affect the lives of the building blocks of our societies, our fellow human beings. We realize that this will give us the platform to join with all dispute resolvers and peacemakers to ensure that our fellow citizens have the necessary tools available and clear avenues to return to normalcy in a timely, efficient, cost-effective, and peaceful manner. In fact, it is my sincerest belief that we have an excellent opportunity to take ADR to another level as a result of our immediate past experiences. Listen to me carefully. Accessibility to quality, timely justice is a global right. I intend to reach out to all like-minded entities globally and continue this great vision. I want to speak a bit about the Institute's strategic plan, the plan that our Director General, Catherine Dixon, and her team has carefully crafted that has been adopted after consultation with our members and our branches and has been distilled into the strategic aims, and these are as follows. Globally promote the constructive resolution of disputes, to become an inclusive global thought leader, and to develop and support an inclusive global community of diverse dispute resolvers, thus embodying the themes of inclusivity, communication, diversity, and continuity. This roadmap has started us on a journey that, if properly adhered to, is flexible enough to promote the global growth of the Institute within the ADR industry and allow us to retain our position as the number one ADR organization in the world. We will continue to work to improve our members' experience by investing in our people, ensuring equality, diversity, and inclusion in all jurisdictions where our branches currently exist and where we expand to. So what is the way forward? I believe that we stick with the plan. I have no doubt that the incoming team will be great ambassadors for the Institute. The team that I will be passing the baton on should expect no surprises. We will be embracing inclusivity in our discussions. We will allow for plans in the Institute to be widely shared and discussed through open communication. The need for diversity is the engine of growth. We will be ensuring that this is one of the main action points, as this is the outward signal of germination and growth. And I will ensure the need for continuity. This need for a steady, persistent flow of positive progression is what we, the leaders and ambassadors of this great institution, are charged with. I too will encourage and offer partnership and friendship going forward to ensure, you guessed it, inclusivity, communication, diversity, and continuity. I intend to continue this great vision and thus embodying these themes. This, my colleagues, has started. I have endeavored to meet each of the branch chairs to ensure that we all feel they have a direct line to me. I have met with the Deputy Global President and the Vice President to ensure that we are all on the same page and enjoy their counsel as together we create opportunities, navigate challenges, and celebrate successes as an organization. Ultimately, we must enhance access to justice, and this will best strengthen the rule of law. If we seek to enhance access to justice, provide a timely, cost-effective, and convenient inviting conduit to justice, we will see an improvement in the life at all levels. We must inculcate this approach of ADR in our schools, in our communities, in our legal systems, and in our private sector industries and businesses. As a result, I promise you, we will see an expeditious improvement in our children's lives, the future building blocks of our society. An immediate improvement in our communities, the homes of our citizens. A further warming to the judicial system, enhancing the correct and appropriate approach to resolving disputes. And also in our approach to business and commerce, the way we trade, the way we want to be dealt with. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So what we are engaging in is a groundswell approach, an activity that will affect local life, your regional life, and ultimately global life, and of course worldwide citizenship. We have an obligation to do what is in our grasp to ensure and preserve the rights of a global citizen, to do the right to their right to quick, easy, and affordable justice. Transforming the accessibility of justice globally is definitely a game changer. We cannot do it alone. Like-minded jurisdictions and organizations such as the DRF, the Private Sector Organization of Jamaica, and other partnerships must pool our collective cerebrals and other resources, and this will lead to success. Make no mistake, this approach is historical. It is legal and it is moral. Together, we represent a vision for the world in which we are all respected and have an opportunity to fulfill our potential. This is where inevitable conflicts can be resolved in a timely manner with minimum harm and loss, whether we are a business person, an individual, a community, or a state. We are all dispute disruptors. Let me say it again. We are all dispute disruptors, and we are committed to supporting the efforts of all well-thinking organizations and individuals, as well as any state, to having the capacity to reach a gold standard by effective dispute resolution that is going to be built on strong, reliable justice system where we proudly can say we can receive justice for all. In continuation of the vision promulgated and lessons gleaned over the past pandemic years, I envisage the following. As I mentioned previously, a specific set of protocols that will provide training to elite first responder type ADR practitioners. It is also my intention to lay down a marker for all like-minded individuals and organizations to bond together in a common accord. Further, I will not lose sight of valuable experience gleaned by our former presidents, and I pledge to utilize the wonderful resource afforded to me at Bloomsbury Square in the United Kingdom, or if moved to Jamaica, right? I've been invited to and will visit either in person, virtually, or both, all the branches as I extend a warm welcome to the branches to visit the Americas, the Caribbean, or best yet, Jamaica. I pledge to practice what I believe, the practice of appropriate dispute resolution. I pledge to be a listening ear for all who need to be listened to, and a voice for those who feel they are not heard. I pledge to be a unifier, and I pledge to make you proud of our illustrious organization. I recognize that this cannot be attained without your support, and I thank you for giving me the support necessary to achieve our aims. And in closing, I want to thank you, friends, leaders, colleagues, brethren, and thank you, Chartered Institute of Arbitrators. As I began, so shall I end. Thank you, God. Thank you.
I know you may feel that that was applause, but I invite you to be upstanding and give a real shout out to our president. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. President. We extend every good wish for a tenure that is personally fulfilling and which advances the strategic objectives of this global organization. We want to thank Jane Gunn, the outgoing president, for her congratulatory message which she sent, which we were not able to broadcast fully, but we hope you will be able to see that later. You know, it's very good that Solan Blanket was able to be with us today. She's seated in the second row, as well as our first patron of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators in the Caribbean, Sir Dennis Byron, who has been a really strong supporter. Everything John asks, he advises, and then he says yes. And that's really made it easier to progress as John has done. It is my hope that we'll be able to share John's speech with you by email, because I think it is worthy of another read, another listen, and there may be nuggets in there that we can all incorporate. Donna, you think? Yes. So we are coming to the end of this segment of the evening's proceedings. Minister Chuck, I convey my appreciation and that of John and Paulette and the team that stands with him. We're grateful to you for the time you took and for the lively presentation filled with important bits of information and commitment that you provided. John has asked us to work together to achieve good things for our fellow citizens. In this room, we have the best and strongest of who we are, not just in Jamaica, but beyond. Let us fulfill the promise of this moment. Let it not just go by as another attainment of a title. It's far more than that to John, and it can be far more than that to us. As we bring the formalities to a close, I ask you to be available for photographs and to mix, mingle, exchange cards as we enjoy a cocktail reception in the atrium downstairs. So before we go down, anyone who is interested in a photo op with John and Paulette and the minister, please make yourself available to stand on this stage for that to be done. I think it's important for me to extend the appreciation of the planning team to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Foreign Trade and the Jamaican High Commission in London for their important facilitation that has led to John wearing that beautiful insignia of office tonight. I thank all our program participants who are here in person or virtually. I want to acknowledge in person Mr. Giovanni, the talented Williams, son of another talented Jamaican Williams. Never mind Giovanni, we'll always mention your dad because he's so brilliant as you are. Reverend Dr. Devon Dick, childhood friend who has been here to support John all along. His Excellency High Commissioner, Mr. David Shepherd. And of course, Brian Brannan, who is just absolutely happy to be here. And we are so happy to have you here, Brian, for this important occasion. Let me join John in thanking and acknowledging the planning and technical team who have done such a brilliant job to make this a successful event. I'm going to wish you a safe journey home as I thank you for being here. but there are some delights downstairs. We don't want you to leave without participating. But before you do that, I'm going to invite, first of all, the front row to come forward and take a picture on the platform with Mr. Bassie, and then we can have the other rows come up and just take a picture with him till everybody has taken a picture. Is that okay? All right, so John and Paulette, please come forward, along with you, Minister, Donna, Julian. Start on that side. Then I'll invite those in this row to join John and Paulette. Do you want it? Okay. He's the expert, I'm just the talker. That's Rudolph Brown's OD, or is it CD?
You don't want all the front.
Not yet. Who's that? Jesus. We want to record everyone. That's all the decision. Thank you very much. So Paulette and John Renee, and I think that to John here on the I'm sure we're going to post all of these pictures so that you're able to download any one of them that you'd like to have. I was advised that I had not adequately acknowledged the role of the UWI team led by Justine Harrison. They have given excellent, excellent support to today. And as we move into the cocktail area, I'd like to call a name. Someone who is no longer with us, but who contributed a lot to the development of ADR in Jamaica from a long time ago and in recent times and in the region. So as they take the final picture. Yes, very nice. I want to call a name that many of you know. That name is Maurice Stoppy. We want to thank him for all he has done. A round of applause to Maurice Stoppy. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Brown. Would you say you have taken everybody now? Okay. All right. So off to the cocktail area. Thank you all and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thank you.